Hi everyone, welcome to Neil Haley Show. Awesome guest again last week. We have a really interesting guest, but you can go to my website, TollTutor.net, for more information. Twitter, TollTutor, Neil S. Haley, Facebook, LinkedIn, Neil Haley, Instagram, TollTutor, Pinterest, Neil Haley, and Google Plus, Neil Haley. And we continue to grow. Soon I'm going to have a couple of magazine articles in the Pittsburgh area. Excited about what's happening with Neil Haley. But when we have an education segment, because it's kind of funny on my television show, we talk about different things from marriage to authors to entertainers. But I'm excited to welcome the program from the National Fair and Open Testing, Bob Schaefer. Bob, thanks for calling. And you know what, Bob? You and I are going to have a nice back and forth conversation because standardized testing is becoming a big business, and yet I think the kids are losing out. And there's a lot of different things that you see when you see numbers, and you get concerned about at times, right, Bob?
That's right. Standardized testing has become the primary way our schools judge students, teachers, and districts. And it's dumbing down the quality of education, hurting educational quality and equity.
And I completely agree in the like the K through 12 model of standardized testing. It just really has become all that they're doing is looking at that standardized test score. If the kids score well, they're going to be treated very fairly. They're going to be get extra privileges. The teachers are going to be really motivated to work with those kids. But when the kids that aren't performing well, then it becomes more and more homework for those kids, more and more after school tutoring, and it's all about the almighty test, right, Bob?
Well, what happens is that the test becomes the curriculum,
Yes.
and in the
Yeah.
worst cases, schooling becomes little more than test preparation. Kids do worksheets and take practice tests, and anything that's not on the test is dropped from the curriculum. So we have really narrowed educational opportunities for those students in low-scoring schools.
Definitely. Bob, how did you get involved in this? Tell us your background and why being part of this organization and out there speaking about the unfairness of sometimes of standardized testing.
FairTest, the National Center for Fair and Open Testing, was founded 30 years ago, and I was the person who founded the organization knew me from some other work and knew that I had previously worked at the Education Research Center at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and asked me to help him put the new organization together, and I've continued working with FairTest since 1985 when it was founded. The reason the organization exists is that there was a conference of leaders of education reform, civil rights, and student activist groups who decided that there needed to be an independent, standalone organization to serve as a watchdog of the standardized testing industry and advocate for better forms of assessment. And that created FairTest.
But what's happened is something that you don't like seeing, Bob. Before, standardized testing was not the end all be all 30 years ago. We go through these cycles, but now it's becoming extremely rampant and extremely the only thing. And also the assessment of teachers as well, Bob, and the stress that they're under just for those kids to perform well on 2 to 3 days of tests, for sure.
Well, we've seen several waves back and forth of more testing and less testing. And right
Yes.
now we're seeing two contradictory waves. Indeed, in the K-12 public school arena,
Right.
there's been an explosion of testing, particularly in the last decade since No Child Left Behind
Yes.
became the federal law. But in the university admissions realm, we've seen a greater number of schools every year drop their standardized testing requirements, go SAT and ACT optional, and have made the test less important in that realm. And the difference we see is that the decision in higher education is generally being made by educators consistent with their mission and the data, and the decisions in the K-12 realm are made by
Right.
politicians governed by lobbyists and campaign contributors who know almost nothing about education, and they've latched on to high-stakes standardized tests as a gimmick that makes them look like they're doing something about education when they're really not.
To tell an effective teacher, Bob, and I try to tell this all the time on my program and to other people, is a teacher that effectively can teach content that they're able to retain and understand. A standardized test can't fit all of that great information in all the content that's available for kids to learn and apply and understand. Think of the sciences, think of math, and the just amazing amount of material that you have to learn, and yet they're being slighted because they put into a very small, little, tiny standardized test and miss lots of key things that are very, very important in the growth of that student.
Yes, yeah, so there's an old adage in the measurement profession, which is what you test is what you get. And when you run our schools based on the results of simple-minded, multiple-choice tests, whether they're given on pencil and paper or increasingly right. nowadays on computer, you end up in dumbing down education to drill students on the very narrow facts and little bits of writing that those tests can measure. And that hurts educational quality. It forces teachers to become mechanical test prep tutors rather than real educators who help kids grow and flourish and develop the kinds of knowledge that they will need to do well in college and in life.
Absolutely, Bob, and I completely agree with you. And it's interesting when you look at both areas. So we'll kind of continue to touch upon the one. The testing becomes so much, and now it's creeping into our private education systems like Catholic schools. More and more they're getting on the whole Board of Common Core, teaching to the test, not covering curriculum anymore. And I think that's the saddest part is, Bob, you have a textbook. And you know, let's just go with math because that's, again, one of my expertise, that if you don't cover an entire year of math and cover everything in algebra, these kids will struggle for years and years to really master mathematics, am I correct? Because they're not the teachers aren't able to cover the entire curriculum, only certain points of a test.
Well, that's right. And once a test has been administered, teachers know what kind of topics it covers.
Right.
And the result is that they limit instruction to what they know is going to be on the test. I mean, that there are even worse things happen. There's in Atlanta, Georgia, a jury is considering a case in which dozens of educators have been charged with absolute cheating,
yes,
manipulating test scores to make their students' outcomes look better than they were.
And
that's
jobs,
because
right,
teachers
yeah.
are judged by those test scores.
And do you really think I'm an SAT prep, ACT prep tutor, and
mm-hmm.
And when I prepare kids for this test, and specifically, it looks like it's more of teaching them a lot of stuff that they've missed out on. The ability to comprehend. We don't teach kids anymore to comprehend material, understand it, look at characters, be able to actively read. We don't teach them to take notes anymore. They miss the boat on specifically how to use Bloom's taxonomies to be able to go through a process and analyze things. And these kids are missing out. So when the big standardized tests like the ACT and SAT come out, a lot of kids, the gaps that were not taught K through 12 really hurt their test scores later on. So there's a lot of reteaching I have to do when I work with kids preparing them for that test. It's not just like, okay, test prep. We're looking at the whole ball of wax and a lot of skills that have been missed out based on what you've been telling me the last 10 years.
Well, right. If those topics and skills were not measured by the test in K-12, in many school districts, they're
right.
simply dropped from the curriculum.
Goodbye.
Because though they may be important for kids' future success on the SAT or in college, if they don't add up to more points on the state test that's required, there's no reason to teach it. That's the reason we've seen
right.
much less time devoted in schools in recent years to subjects like art and music and
right.
physical education, and even in some states, social studies and sciences,
right.
because they're not on the test, and therefore there's no value in teaching them, since schools, students, and teachers are not evaluated on what's not tested.
That's so true. And again, we're talking to Bob Schaefer from FairTest, National Center for Fair and Open Testing. And Bob, I don't know if we're going to completely agree in this whole half hour, because I am becoming a fan at times of specifically looking at certain skill sets going on to college, but you'll probably say you throw out those standardized tests, kids are lacking certain things. So I think you'll agree with me where we're going from here. From the ability of not having textbooks anymore, eliminating textbooks. The Pittsburgh Public Schools, I was in there this week helping tutor kids, and I'm like, where's your books? We don't have books. Well, what do you have? A worksheet. They just were going through a worksheet, and they're just basically checking off standards and then say, okay, we know that's going to be a kind of question on the standardized test. So they're, especially in the less affluent schools, you're seeing this more and more. So going through that process of not working with them, going through it, it leads to when they get to college, what kind of product once administrators, once they get admitted to these colleges and they find out they can't do really what it's necessary to be prepared for college. Tell us some stories about that. I'm sure you're seeing that as part of this whole standardized testing, less kids really being able to develop.
That's right. I mean, that they learn how to do well on the narrow skills that are measured by the state standardized test.
Right.
They do that through practice on worksheets and the like. And when it comes time to college, where you're on your own, you have to read books, you have to think
yes.
and analyze, and write real essays. The kids need remedial courses because they're simply not ready. The test they took in public school say they've mastered material, but they really haven't learned how to learn
courses,
and
yes.
don't have the basis of information they need or the skills to do well in higher education or in the job market.
Well, I'm going to speak out to one area, and so you talked about the great important parts of preparing kids for college, and start to speak to the private institutions, especially the Catholic schools across the United States and the Christian academies and different things. You're missing the boat if you start looking at standardized testing. You're going to narrow their focus and not develop them as well-rounded individuals that are going to be prepared for college. There are many kids that are lower B students go to college and excel once they figure out what their passion is. So by narrowing the focus to reading and math, and if you're not very good in reading and math, you're not going to amount to anything. We're creating a system that tracks kids and doesn't help them reach their full potential. So when we get back, more Bob Schaefer, and excited to kind of go into the whole college end of things. Because I don't know about eliminating the ACT and SAT, because I think that, and I've seen some of the reasons why they've done it, but they still have it as an option. You're watching The Neil Haley Show. We'll get more back with Bob Schaefer. We'll be back in just a moment.
Andy Amrine, EV True Value Hardware, with the Bethel Park Volunteer Scholarship Fund. This prize here that my fellow producers and I are standing behind is a Weber SP310 stainless steel propane barbecue grill.
We have the greatest stainless steel Weber grill in history. Come buy these $1 tickets right now.
These tickets are available now at multiple Bethel Park locations.
Tickets are available every day, 7 days a week at EV True Value Hardware.
Here at the front desk at the library.
Tickets are also available at BP TV's offices during regular office hours. If the lights are on, come on in. We're friendly. We promise. We'll sell you tickets. Who's doing that?
You heard the locations. I am a location. Come and see me or out in the streets on my show. You'll get the talking machine going with buying $1 tickets everywhere.
Mayor Allen will pull the winning ticket during the regular council meeting on Monday, June 8th, live on BP TV.
Thank you for supporting the Bethel Park Volunteer Scholarship Fund. Buy your tickets today.
Or else.
We'll be right back. We're back to the Neil Haley Show, and I'm with Bob Schaefer from Fair Test, National Center for Fair and Open Testing. And Bob, enjoying the conversation, completely agreeing with you, but we'll go away from this that I talk on my show ad nauseum, and that's the whole standardized testing K through 12, and talk about the new shift of eliminating in some universities and colleges the ACT and SAT. And what is your take? Do you believe there needs to be, first, that's the first question. Do you believe there needs to be an ACT and an SAT test as part of the admissions, for admissions to certain colleges and universities, all colleges and universities? Do you believe it's needed?
Well, Fair Test has long been the leader of the test optional admissions movement, in which now 850 accredited bachelor degree granting institutions do not require all or many applicants to submit either ACT or SAT scores. It's less important what you or I believe as compared to what colleges know from their own evidence. And they have concluded that in many cases, test scores don't add anything to an admissions profile. And you mentioned before the break, Catholic schools in the K-12 realm. In fact, in the higher education arena, Catholic colleges like Holy Cross and DePaul and Providence College and St. Joseph have been among the leaders in adopting test optional admission as ways to advance their admission and to improve both educational quality and equity. Their evidence shows that test scores don't add materially to the information on which they base admissions decisions.
But does that, what about when you're talking certain colleges and universities, the differentiation process of you only can admit a certain amount? Do you feel that that should be part of the measurement at all?
Well, right now, about 47 of the top 100 liberal arts colleges in the country, the most competitive liberal arts schools, are test score optional. You know, places like Brandeis and Bates have found that they don't need test scores to do admissions well. We're not saying ban the ACT or SAT. If an applicant seriously believes that filling in bubbles on a Saturday morning add something material to their portfolio, they should go ahead and take the test and set in the scores. But college after college, another two dozen, dropped their test score requirements just in the past year. College after college has found that test scores are not needed and that you can do high-quality admissions without requiring the ACT or SAT. And there's a list of those schools on our website, fairtest.org.
Interesting, Bob. Let me give you my, be a little bit of a devil's advocate in a certain situation. If, again, we're not getting kids K through 12 prepared for college. And now if scores are watered down based on standardized testing is the end all be all, and you're seeing less of the honors courses and AP courses really giving that what's needed for them to be prepared for college. If you see grades that are inflated and then you admit them and you don't have a standardized test, what if that's showing that really we're not seeing them, that the preparation process, at least that test can show that maybe there's some areas they need improvement on? Maybe there's areas, how can admissions really kind of look at that specifically for certain students if you're having school districts across the country that are just not performing or preparing kids for college? That's the point I'm saying. Not getting rid of it altogether. You're saying some of these schools are making it optional. Yeah. I'm just concerned about how poorly run some of our public high schools are that with that less of the scope and sequence of things. And so that,
well,
yeah.
You know, the findings by colleges which have gone test optional is that they can make high-quality admissions decisions about which kids are likely to succeed without regard to test scores. I mean, one of the problems with relying on test scores is that good test prep tutors like you can help boost the scores of applicants who enroll in their courses.
Yes.
So an admissions officer really can't tell whether that 650 on the math SAT was the result of a kid taking the test cold or after 30 hours of excellent tutoring, which helped boost his score by 150 points. So they have decided, and we're talking about lots of places in Pennsylvania, Gettysburg, Chatham and Muhlenberg.
Oh, wow.
And the eastern part of the state, Bryn Mawr, and other highly selective schools have all concluded that you don't need to require test scores. Carlisle and Dickinson and Carlisle is another one. There are probably 30 test optional colleges now in Pennsylvania.
Wow. But how are they? I guess they really have to take a look at what the product is of that high school then. They do.
Requires admissions officers to know more about the individual schools from which students apply and to read their applications much more diligently. Franklin and Marshall in Philadelphia, for example, which has been a leader, ask kids to send in graded essays from their high school classes so that it's skilled admissions officers can use their knowledge and experience from the profession to look at what kids actually can write, something that you don't see on a standardized test at all.
And which the SATs get rid of writing altogether, which I'm sure you're like, really?
They're going to make the essay section optional again, just like on the ACT.
But they still have to take it, or could the kids just say, I'm not going to take it at all, the SAT, when it comes out?
The new SAT, which is going to be administered for the first time next year, is in 2016, will have an optional essay. And students will need to figure out whether the school that they're applying to require that. But they will have a choice when they take the test of stopping before the writing section or continuing to do it.
So they'll make the essay the last question, probably the last part of the test. So
that's right. The new essay will be at the end of the test. Right now, up till March 2016, the essay on the SAT is the first portion of the test.
You know why they do that? To burn
well, I know how they. The reason they gave for it is that they find that if you had a tough essay section, you may not be able to do the rest of the test. But they've now changed their argument and moved the essay from the beginning to the end.
And one thing I think that I don't like about testing is it's all to trick the kids. That's why. But I look at when I tutor them to really look at the well-rounded of developing that individual things that they're lacking. But the test is all meant to trip kids up, to make them confused. Yeah, go ahead.
That's right. I mean, tests are designed to differentiate among test takers. And to do that, you need deceptive answers that lure people to make the wrong choice. You need some questions that are extremely hard. And you need kinds of mind games in which the SAT has specialized in order to get spread scores across the spectrum. But that creates a situation in which knowledgeable tutors, and there are lots of folks who can do a good job of boosting test scores, can take kids and teach them how to do the test. Doesn't make them better students, doesn't make them better prepared for college or careers, but they get higher scores on the test, and that gives them real advantages at schools that require the SAT or ACT for admission or for scholarship aid.
Do you want it all to be eliminated altogether, or you think it should be a different?
No, parents want tests to be optional. We're not saying ban the SAT or ACT. We favor the kind of policy that Muhlenberg has had in effect for 20 years, where test scores are optional. The student can decide whether that score from filling in bubbles on one Saturday morning fairly represents her knowledge and skills or not. And the admissions offices allow applicants to make that choice.
I work with a guy named Darnell Dinkins from Ethic Training Dynamite Sports. He's a former Super Bowl champion, and he is really the NCAA has not done that. The college athlete, it's definitely not an optional test, and so it's something where for eligibility purposes they have to put it out there. Do you think that's a good idea, Bob? I think maybe for kids that are really remedial, that you gotta be able to see if they can do something on specific tests, so that you don't have kids that literally can't read get into college. What is your thought with the NCAA?
Fair Test has long been involved in NCAA reform, and were involved in a lawsuit against what had been their previous rule, which was an absolute score cutoff. On the SAT. What the NCAA has in effect now is a sliding scale where depending on the student-athlete's grade, they need to maintain, get a specific test score. So the higher your grade, the the lower your test score requirement is. We think that's a better system, though. There are leaders within the NCAA who are pushing to get rid of the test score requirement entirely.
Wow.
You know, it creates a funny situation where schools that are test score optional for nearly all applicants still have to use test scores for student-athletes because the NCAA says so.
Do you think we're going to get to that point where it's going to be not an optional thing again for the NCAA?
It's hard to tell. I mean, the NCAA, and I've been to four NCAA national conventions to talk about this issue. The NCAA is an incredibly political institution in which image is much more important than substance. Just turn on your TV today and watch the March Madness.
Yes.
Tens of billions of dollars are at stake because of the NCAA's image. And their judgment seems to be driven not by what is best for students or for the admissions process, but what makes the NCAA look good and get bigger contracts from the TV network.
So I got to give you about a minute. What's the newest news with your organization that you want to promote right now? What's going on?
Well, the new news has been the explosion of test optional admissions in the past year. More schools have dropped SAT, ACT requirements in the last 12 months than in any year in history.
Amazing.
It's a couple dozen have gone test score optional. And we expect that movement to accelerate as the new SAT, with all its confusing attributes, is introduced next year.
Yeah, with Common Core. It's going to be interesting. It's going to be an interesting thing. I'm going to be busy, Bob, learning this specifically new test. And people are already recommending take the ACT. It's a more straightforward test. I'm sure you would say the ACT is a better test than the SAT.
Well, actually, we wouldn't say it's a better test. We'd say it's a different test. It has been a more consumer-friendly test, and it's going to be a test which, if you start studying for now, won't change next year. So there are reasons for students to think about the ACT rather than the SAT if they're going to take one test.
All right, website quickly again, Bob.
The website is www.fairtest.com. FAIRTEST.org.
Well, I'll definitely have you back on when you have some new news for me, Bob. Best of luck and good talking to you.
Thanks for the opportunity, Neil.
All right, take care, Bob. All right.
Bye.
All right. That was the Neil Haley Show and education. So it was almost like total education with Neil. Enjoyed the conversation. Radical views we're seeing. Again, go to my website, TollTutor.net, for more information. Twitter, TollTutor, Neil S. Haley, Facebook. Colleges are looking to make it optional, while on the other hand, it's becoming test, test, test. That's why parents need to opt out. Take care, guys, and we'll watch next week. Watch the Neil Haley Show. Good day, everyone, and I'm looking forward to next week's guests.